thank you very much. Thank you, Claudia, for organizing this session. The Isle of Man and its famous Manx crosses. You may know that the Isle of Man is a rather small island in the middle of the Irish Sea, and it boasts a large number of medieval stone monuments, more than 200 of them, found at several sites all over the island. Many of the early examples of these stones are rather crudely hewn stone slabs with an incised cross, like this example from Margold. But in the later 9th century, predominantly pagan Vikings conquered the island and settled there, and gradually accepted Christianity and adopted this tradition of stone crosses and cross stones, and adapted the decoration of it for their own tastes and styles. And this occasionally resulted in an intriguing mixture of pagan and Christian motifs right next to the Christian cross. And among this decoration were a number of animals, those including, of course, the birds. And just as a mention for the dates, the earliest stones are decorated in the Borre style and often with the emblematic ring chain motif, and date to about the middle of the 10th century. In numbers, as far as the birds are concerned, there are 21 birds, 21 individual birds on 9 crosses from 5 sites. And I'll begin with the most difficult one, which is here on this stone from Kirkmichael in the upper right corner. There seems to be a bird above a human, which is half lying on the ground. And literature, as far as I can see, has been unable to provide a really convincing interpretation. There is one idea that the man is, in fact, Christ, with the bird being his attribute, an eagle, and Christ being, ascending to heaven. And then on the other side, there is also an idea that it is a dead man on the battlefield being pecked at by an eagle or raven. Perhaps Catherine will have to say something on that in the next paper. So I don't pretend to be able to say anything on this one, and leave it at that. With the next one, we are on slightly firmer ground. On this stone in Bride, there are no less than 4 animals, and 2 of them are on the top, sitting on the ring of the cross, but we will return to them later and start with, there they are, and we begin with those 2. On the left, there is, underneath the ring, a small bird next to a man with a spear, pointing the spear to the forehead of a stag, which is pursued by 2 dogs. And on the right is a rather strange-looking creature next to a man, and again, a stag and a dog. Now, a somewhat similar motif in general terms can be seen on this stone in Kirkmichael again. There are 3 birds here, and we begin with the 2 on the top. Again, there's a stag, probably pursued by a hound again, and 2 birds, one of them actually sitting on the back of the stag, the other one flying across atop the scene. And as in the case of the Bride stone, I think that this is an instance of a hunting scene, which includes falconry, the most prestigious form of hunting. A similar image is here on this cross from Kirriemuir in Scotland, a stag with a bird hovering over the back, and a hound there as well. Now, there may be instances of trained eagles attacking deer, but in general terms, this is not exactly what an eagle would do, especially not when it's a case of a well-antlered, heavy stag. That would be very dangerous for the bird. Instead, I think it would be more a matter of smaller game. that falcons and eagles are being used to for hunting. But then there is this figure. In former research, it is generally called the great bird. Actually, I think the idea that it is, in fact, a woman in a flowing dress is, well, has pretty much to say for it. But then there's this drawing from about 1907, which, a bit Disney-esque, looks to me like a bird, a seabird, preening its plumage. And the idea of a waterfowl in a hunting scene is not exactly very strange. There are several Irish crosses with their bases decorated with some hunting or hunting-like scenes where there are hunters or armed men pursuing groups of animals. There are boar, there are stags, there are hounds, and in several cases, waterfowl. And on the cross from Kirkmichael, there are several other birds, other animals, an ox, possibly, well, deer, perhaps, or horses. So I think we are pretty much on the safe side saying that this is a hunting scene in general, including falconers and the waterfowl, if this is indeed a bird being the prey of the hunters. The hunting scene is quite regular on the stones of the Manx crosses, with the one in the middle. On the other side, there are many more examples. There are boar again and the bear. There are ox and rams. So it is not exactly a rare motif. And well, the hunt, as we have just heard, is an old motif for gravestones. And one example is here, this footstool from the settlement site of the Fallwart in Germany, where there's a hound attacking the back of a stag and a runic inscription reading deer damaging. And then there is this stone, which is, well, with these two stones, which are referring to the story of Sigurd the Dragon Slayer. And of course, there's, I'm sorry, I just. Okay. First, of course, there's Sigurd killing the dragon Fafnir, stabbing the worm-like monster, and then roasting the heart of the monster on a spit over open fire. And when he tries the meat, whether it's done, he burns his finger and puts his finger or his thumb into his mouth. And the moment the dragon's blood touches his lip, he can understand the language of the birds in the trees above him, and they warn him that his companion Regin is going to kill him. And here are on those two stones in Kirk Andreas and Kirk Andreas and in Jerby, and there are two very, very small instances of birds looking over Sigurd's shoulder. And the idea of birds is very common in illustrations of the Sigurd legend. Such example for here, this stone in Halton, not very far from here and not far from the Isle of Man itself. And the stones, of course, give no indication of any ornithological identification of the birds, but the saga text that relates the story says that they are titmice. And then we return to the two birds on the top of the bride stone. There is no indication as to their identity, but they are antithetic on top of the cross, just the same as this one, this pair of birds on the stone of Morgul, directly on the cross, arms of the cross. And in Kirk Andreas, sitting looking at each other on the two cross arms, two birds, and on the other face of the stone, the same situation. The idea of two antithetical birds on cross arms, whether on top of it or right on it, is not exactly very common, but I found this illumination of the Pauline epistles in Würzburg. These two animals, these two birds, are generally called peacocks and are being identified as symbols for immortality. Even earlier is this picture of the Domitia sarcophagus in the Vatican, where two birds are looking up at the Cairo, symbolizing the Anastasis of Christ, and thus the promise of resurrection, the new day, as it were, being chimed in, chirped in by the birds. So the generic birds in the two upper examples may have been meant in quite the same way. But then on the Andreas cross, the birds are not exactly, they are different from each other. And on this stone from Michael is another bird with quite a rich detail. And for completeness sake, there is one more on this stone from Kirkmichael, but those are isolated without a counterpart. But due to the detail, we can quite confidently say that they are cocks. And the two birds on the lower left, especially the one of the upper one, can be identified as a dove. So what does this mean? The dove is well known as a symbol for peace and peacefulness, but as there is no sign of any olive branch, which is quite common to identify this, it's more likely that here the bird is meant to symbolize the Holy Spirit, as given in Matthew 3:16, that is relating that on being baptized, the Spirit of God descended as a dove coming upon Christ. Strangely enough, the cock is a bit more of a problem. Of course, it is to us a very known, very well-known symbol to announce the new day, which goes in the same way as the two antithetic birds I mentioned before, chiming in, crowing in the new day, even the new day after death. But this is not mentioned in the Bible, and I've been looking for any sign of symbolic use here, and I came on this very modern gravestone in Kilmallock in Ireland, where there is actually a cock among the Arma Christi, and the Roman poet Prudentius in the late 4th century draws a picture himself by the, saying the cock singing exultantly to wake the dead. So I take it we can accept the cock as being a symbol of the Christian resurrection. Then there is this stone in Jerby, a badly weathered stone which may convey a similar message, but possibly with a Norse pagan background. In the upper right corner, there is a man armed with a sword and blowing a horn. And originally, there seems to have been a bird flying over him. Now, on a Scandinavian stone, a man blowing a horn may tentatively be identified as the Norse god Heimdallr, the watchman of Asgard, blowing his Gjallarhorn to warn the gods of the beginnings of the Ragnarök, the fateful battle of the gods against the giants and the forces of chaos, as told in the Eddas Völuspá. And Heimdallr is assisted here by the cock Gyllinkammi, who is waking the gods so that the bird on the Jerby stone might well be, or may have been meant as a cock, even though according to the drawing it does not really look that way. But then in the Bible, trumpets are also blown to announce, here's the Edda on Gyllinkammi, and the Bible relates that the trumpets shall be sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. But there, of course, it's not some sword-wielding warrior, but the angels sounding the trumpets. So basically we have someone playing the trumpet and birds calling out the new day after death. So it seems to me that here, both in pagan and in Christian imagery, the apocalyptic scenarios of the Ragnarok and of the Day of Judgment were to be conveyed in different languages, but the same concept. So the point being, of course, that after the Ragnarok, life goes on. The Ragnarok is not the end of the Norse world, it is sometimes said to be, it goes on. And I think this is shown by the last example from this stone in Kirkandreas. There is a bird sitting on top of the shoulder of a man with a spear, pointing the spear down towards a four-legged animal, a wolf-like, dog-like animal that seems to bite the man in the foot. And of course, again, a Norse identification comes to mind, one told in the Edda, that Odin, in the fateful fight, will fight the Fenris wolf, and the wolf will swallow Odin, and this will be the cause of his death. The bird then would, of course, be a raven, one of Odin's well-established familiars and attributes. Many scholars have taken the scene to depict the end of Odin and the end of the world, Norse world in general. But when you look at the other side, actually like turning a leaf in a book, there is a man wielding a book and a cross, a fish in front of him, and the man is treading on the serpents. And this seems to illustrate Psalm 91:13 of the Bible. And when one is looking at the strange posture of the man with a dog, with a very short leg in the mouth of the animal, and a very long arm reaching down to the jaws, I think that a different identification may be very possible here, that instead of Odin and Odin's death, there is Vidar shown here. Vidar is Odin's son, and he is going to kill the monster after it has swallowed Odin, his father. And the point being, with one hand he will grasp the wolf's upper jaw and tear apart his mouth, and that will cause the wolf's death. And Vidar is one of the very few Norse gods who will survive the apocalypse of the Ragnarök and will live to found a cleansed new world. And in this, a parallelization may be possible between Christ and Vidar, both Son of God, and both victorious in their fights against death. And this would turn the scenes of the Kirkandreas stone into renderings of the same very Christian message, the promise of resurrection. And the raven in this scene would be little more than an echo of the old pagan mythology. So to sum up, the birds of the Manx crosses represent a number of different motifs and purposes. There are old traditions that probably celebrate the dead man's prowess and heroic valor, and there are also birds that are part of motifs with clearly religious meaning. In a way, that is only possible in a transitional society when residual pagans and native Christians were coming to terms with each other, and the iconography of the Manx gravestones conveys thus a common message, the common message of the resurrection, regardless of pagan or Christian manifestation, the anthestatic birds, the cocks, the doves of Christ, as well as Odin's raven. Thank you very much.